Thus says the high and lofty one who inhabits eternity, whose name is holy. I dwell in the high and holy place and also with the one who has a contrite and humble spirit, to revive the spirit of the humble and to revive the heart of the contrite. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
Lord, open our lips,
and our mouths shall proclaim your praise.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Alleluia.
The earth is the Lord's, for he made it.
Come, let us adore him.
Let us say together the Venite. Come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us shout for joy to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving and raise a loud shout to him with psalms. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In his hand are the caverns of the earth, and the heights of the hills are his also. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands have molded the dry land. Come, let us bow down and bend the knee and kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. Oh, that today you would hearken to his voice.
Our psalm today is Psalm 15. Let's read it responsibly by whole verse. Lord, who may dwell in your tabernacle? Who may abide on your holy hill?
Whoever leads a blameless life and does what is right, who speaks the truth from his heart.
There is no guile upon his tongue. He does no evil to his friend. He does not heap contempt upon his neighbor.
In his sight, the wicked is rejected, but he honors those who fear the Lord.
He has sworn to do no wrong and does not take back his word.
He does not give his money in hope of gain, nor does he take a bribe against the innocent.
Whoever does these things shall never be overthrown.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Amen.
A reading from the letter to the Colossians. The Son is the image of the invisible God, the one who is first created over all creation. Because all things were created by him, both in the heavens and on the earth, the things that are visible and the things that are invisible. Whether they are thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. He existed before all things, and all things are held together in him. He is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning. The one who is firstborn from among the dead, so that he might occupy the first place in everything. Because all the fullness of God was pleased to live in him, and he reconciled all things to himself through him, whether things on earth or in the heavens. He brought peace through the blood of his cross. Once you were alienated from God, and you were enemies with him in your minds, which was shown by your evil actions. But now he has reconciled you by his physical body through death to present you before God as a people who are holy, faultless, and without blame. But you need to remain well established and rooted in faith, and not shift away from the hope given in the good news that you heard. This message has been preached throughout all creation under heaven. And I, Paul, became a servant of this good news. Now I'm happy to be suffering for you. I'm completing what is missing from Christ's sufferings with my own body. I'm doing this for the sake of his body, which is the church. I became a servant of the church by God's commission, which was given to me for you in order to complete God's word. I'm completing it with a secret plan that has been hidden for ages and generations, but which has now been revealed to his holy people. God wanted to make the glorious riches of the secret plan known among the Gentiles, which is Christ living in you, the hope of glory. This is what we preach as we warn and teach every person with all wisdom, so that we might present each one mature in Christ. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Let us say together Canticle 12, a song of creation. Glorify the Lord, all you works of the Lord. Praise him and highly exalt him forever. In the firmament of his power, glorify the Lord. Praise him and highly exalt him forever. Glorify the Lord, you angels and all powers of the Lord, O heavens and all waters above the heavens. Sun and moon and stars of the sky, glorify the Lord. Praise him and highly exalt him forever. Glorify the Lord, every shower of rain and fall of dew, all winds and fire and heat. Winter and summer, glorify the Lord. Praise him and highly exalt him forever. Glorify the Lord, O chill and cold, drops of dew and flakes of snow. Frost and cold, ice and sleet, glorify the Lord. Praise him and highly exalt him forever. Glorify the Lord, O nights and days, O shining light and enfolding dark. Storm clouds and thunderbolts, glorify the Lord. Praise him and highly exalt him forever. Let us glorify the Lord, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Praise him and highly exalt him forever. In the firmament of his power, glorify the Lord. Praise him and highly exalt him forever.
A reading from the Gospel according to Luke. While Jesus and his disciples were traveling, Jesus entered a village where a woman named Martha welcomed him as a guest. She had a sister named Mary who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to his message. By contrast, Martha was preoccupied with getting everything ready for their meal. So Martha came to him and said, "Lord, don't you care that my sister has left me to prepare the table all by myself? Tell her to help me." The Lord answered, "Martha, Martha, you are worried and distracted by many things. One thing is necessary. Mary has chosen the better part. It won't be taken away from her." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Let us say together the second song of Isaiah. Seek the Lord while he wills to be found. Call upon him when he draws near. Let the wicked forsake their ways and the evil ones their thoughts. And let them turn to the Lord and he will have compassion, and to our God, for he will richly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor your ways my ways, says the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as rain and snow fall from the heavens, and return not again, but water the earth, bringing forth life and giving growth, seed for sowing and bread for eating, so is my word that goes forth from my mouth. It will not return to me empty, but it will accomplish that which I have purposed and prosper in that for which I sent it. Glory to the Father and to the Son and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. What do we do on those occasions when we find ourselves in the presence of the wondrous or the awesome? Sometime in late elementary school, or maybe junior high, I was given the book Stars, a Golden Nature Guide, with 150 paintings in color. I loved that book and the stories about the names of the constellations. And I was eager to go outside at night to see if I could match up the pictures with what I saw in the sky. Now there are apps for that. For several weeks, I was pretty avid about it. The stars were cool and the imaginative constellations captivating. But I grew up in Oregon, and more often than not, the stars were hidden behind clouds, and the fascination faded. I became distracted by other things. But I still remember being able to identify the Big and Little Dippers and Polaris, the North Star, the W of Cassiopeia, and Orion's three-star belt. But stars continued to hold my interest. It was pretty cool, for example, when I spent a year in Australia as an exchange student, to lose sight of the two Dippers and the North Star. The Southern Cross replaced them in that hemisphere's night sky. Also, at that time, the United States was sending folks into space and to the moon. We began to get pictures of Earth from the Apollo crews. Fast forward a few decades, and the views of Earth from outer space captured our attention. There was a great poster from a number of years ago with an arrow pointing to a dot near the Milky Way with the caption, "You are here." Talk about moving away from the Earth as the center of the universe. Copernicus would have been proud. And then we were given the Hubble telescope photos, one called the Pillars of Creation. But this week, the photos from the James Webb Telescope blew us all away. Recalling that progression of photos from the Apollo missions to outer space to Hubble to Webb, those verses from Psalm 8 have kept running through my mind. When I look up at your skies, what your fingers made, the moon and the stars that you set firmly in place, what are human beings that you think about them? What are human beings that you pay attention to them? Awe and wonder. I must admit, however, that most often I don't spend a lot of time anymore looking up at God's skies for any longer than a moment. Even when I know there's some significant astronomical event like an eclipse or the conjunction of planets, I'm just likely to go outside, hoping the night is clear enough, to get a glimpse of the event and then go to bed. It's not unlike what many bird watchers do, myself included. Sometimes we learn about the presence of an unusual bird, get in the car to chase it perhaps miles. We find the gaggle of other birders, look at it for a minute or so, and check it off our list, anxious to get back to other things. I wonder how many of us, no show of hands, how many of us saw one or more of those photos from the Webb telescope, thought, "That's cool," and simply scrolled on to the next post in our Facebook feed or our online newspaper. not reading the accompanying article, much less spending time in contemplation of what we've seen. I mean, we have other important things to do, right? I generally have other things to do. According to Gallup's Strength Finder, I'm an achiever. In other words, the photos are cool, but the lawn needs mowing. What does it take to get us to stop the busyness? Even when that busyness is oh so appropriate or oh so good. What do I miss by looking past something amazing just so that I can get to the next thing, then the next thing, and then the next thing? This is the question that has haunted me as I spent time with the Mary and Martha story this week, a story that's familiar to many and equally frustrating to many. Jesus arrives in a village. John's gospel would tell us it was Bethany. A woman named Martha invites him for dinner and takes on the role of hostess, a significant role with expectations and demands. Much to her annoyance, her sister doesn't step in to help. Then Martha asks Jesus to set Mary straight on hostessing responsibilities. Unexpectedly, Jesus gently upbraids Martha and compliments Mary. What does this mean? There have been a lot of interpretations over the centuries, and I won't recount them all. The one recently that has made the most sense to me requires that we actually read this story as a follow-up to last week's parable of the Good Samaritan. These are the next few verses, after all. Jesus told that story, you'll remember, in the context of a discussion about the greatest commandment being called to love God and to love neighbor. The questioner asked about who was neighbor. The Good Samaritan story was the answer, a story about disregarding religio-cultural expectations to, in some respects, offer hospitality, to aid anyone in need. The Mary and Martha story then tackles another set of expectations, the requirement of hospitality. Now, Jesus seems to set aside the demands of hospitality for the good of discipleship. Or, as I've seen, the Mary Martha story addresses how one loves God, the counterpart to the Good Samaritan teaching how to love neighbor. Two stories in reverse order, illustrating the great commandment. And maybe that's as far as it need go. But I remembered other gospel stories that reported Jesus setting aside cultural or religious norms and wondering if there was a connection. I think of the story where folks wonder why Jesus's disciples don't spend as much time in fasting and prayer as the Pharisees. Jesus's response, you can't make the wedding guests fast while the groom is with them, can you? The days will come when the groom will be taken from them, and then they will fast. I think of a passage we read a few weeks ago where some folks wanted to follow Jesus after attending to the familial distractions of saying goodbye to those at home or burying one's father. Jesus' comment is basically, get your priorities straight. I think of another story about Mary of Bethany from John's gospel in which she washes Jesus' feet. Now she's the one providing hospitality with expensive perfume. Judas Iscariot complains that the money wasted on the perfume should have been given to the poor. You may recall Jesus's response, leave her alone. This perfume was to be used in preparation for my burial, and this is how she has used it. You will always have the poor among you, but you won't always have me. What binds all these together, along with the Mary and Martha story, it seems to me, is the simple assertion. Jesus is here now. Pay attention to him. Yes, spiritual practices like prayer and fasting are important. Yes, Family relations and duties are important. Yes, caring for the poor is important. Yes, the demands of hospitality are important. All of these are God-sanctioned. But when in the presence of, quote, the image of the invisible God, through whom all things were created, both in the heavens and on the earth, the things that are visible and the things that are invisible, who existed before all things, in whom all the fullness of God was pleased to live. That from Colossians. When in that presence, maybe it's time to set aside all of the other things that distract us and about which we worry. The Mary and Martha story, I don't believe that Jesus was saying that the demands of hospitality are unimportant. I also don't believe that Jesus was setting devotion above service. Perhaps Jesus is telling Martha and us that there are times when the greatest expression of hospitality is simply to sit with the gift that is the wondrous, the awesome. Yes, the divine guest, in whatever form that may take, and savor the opportunity. The rest of our worries and distractions can wait a while and maybe become less of a burden. Perhaps in our practice of hospitality, we receive the gift. Amen. Continue our worship with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Hear our cry, O God.
And listen to our prayer.
Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Save your people, Lord, and bless your inheritance.
Govern and uphold them now and always.
Day by day we bless you.
We praise your name forever.
Lord, keep us from all sin today.
Have mercy on us, Lord, have mercy.
Lord, show us your love and mercy.
For we put our trust in you.
In you, Lord, is our hope.
And we shall never hope in vain.
Almighty God, the fountain of all wisdom, you know our necessities before we ask and our ignorance in asking. Have compassion on our weakness and mercifully give us those things which for our unworthiness we dare not and for our blindness we cannot ask. Through the worthiness of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Almighty and everlasting God, you made the universe with all its marvelous order, its atoms, worlds, and galaxies, and the infinite complexity of living creatures. Grant that, as we probe the mysteries of your creation, we may come to know you more truly and more surely fulfill our role in your eternal purpose. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
O God, you have made of one blood all the peoples of the earth, and sent your blessed Son to preach peace to those who are far off and to those who are near. Grant that people everywhere may seek after you and find you. Bring the nations into your fold. Pour out your spirit upon all flesh and hasten the coming of your kingdom through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
If there are anniversaries or birthdays to celebrate today, please put those in the chat. We celebrate with you these milestones. And let us pray together. Watch over your servants, O Lord, as their days increase. Bless and guide them wherever they may be. Strengthen them when they stand. Comfort them when discouraged or sorrowful. Raise them up if they fall. And in their hearts, may your peace, which passes all understanding, abide all the days of their lives, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Happy birthday, happy anniversary. Well, welcome, everyone. Glad you are here, joining us virtually or later if you're watching this afterwards. Happy that this is an opportunity that you have chosen to avail yourself of. And just a couple of announcements. As I said last week, we're in July. There's not as much going on as often there is, but there are some things to pay attention to. One is that you all know that we are in the middle of our capital campaign to raise funds to make sure that we can improve the quality of the sound in the sanctuary for all of those who are in person, but also improve the sound and eventually the video capacity that we have in the sanctuary so that those who are joining us remotely for reasons of travel or illness or just checking us out will have a really, really good experience. We are about two-thirds of the way to our goal for the sound piece of that campaign. So if you are still thinking and praying about that, I urge you to continue in that process, but to get your pledges in soon so that we can start that work. This is a work of evangelism and pastoral care that we have learned that we need to engage in as a result of our experience with COVID. And it extends our voice a long, long way. So please consider this as well. Also, Dave Matthews, parishioner who frequently usually attends the later service, is a contractor and has done a lot of work around Good Shepherd. He is inviting some folks to help him put together a ramp, not for the church, but this would be for somebody that the Home Builders Association has learned needs a temporary ramp built into their house to allow for transportation from car into house for somebody in a wheelchair. If you're interested in working with Dave, learning some carpentry skills, you want to expand your carpentry skills and work with some other folks from Good Shepherd to do that, please, if you know Dave, let him know. If you don't know how to get in touch with Dave, let me know and I'll put you in touch with Dave. But it's a great opportunity to do some ministry in a way that we might not often think of. And now let us close with prayer. Let us pray together. Almighty God, you have given us grace at this time with one accord to make our common supplication to you. And you have promised through your well-beloved Son that when two or three are gathered together in his name, you will be in the midst of them. Fulfill now, O Lord, our desires and petitions as may be best for us, granting us in this world knowledge of your truth, and in the age to come, life everlasting.
Amen.
Let us bless the Lord. Alleluia. Alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia. Alleluia.
Glory to God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to him from generation to generation in the church and in Christ Jesus forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.